practically every wisdom tradition of the world is understood. You know, the Greek philosophers, Plato, Aristotle, the Romans, they had a cycle of ages, of four ages, a golden age that's followed by a silver age, followed by a bronze age, followed by an iron age, mm-hmm. after which there's destruction, and then the thing starts all over again. The ancient Sanskrit writings describe a similar cycle, that there's a cycle of ages, which they call yugas. There's a Satya Yuga, a golden age in which most people are very peaceful and spiritual and very healthy and long-lived, and they have very, very advanced abilities, although a very, very simple level of culture.
That's the lifestyle I want again.
Right. Then in the next age, things become a little bit degraded, because the people start developing a little bit of selfishness.
Mm-hmm.
So then they start dividing into classes, and you get a social structure that emerges, and towns and villages and cities begin to emerge. And then in the next stage, it gets a little bit more complicated. And finally, in the fourth age, which we're in now, it's called the Kali Yuga, it's called an age of quarrel and hypocrisy, which was a pretty good prediction, because this was predicted. Yeah, this current age that we're in, it was predicted thousands of years ago in these ancient Sanskrit writings, and the predictions are all coming true.
What caused this horrible, as you would say, devolution to occur? How do we start off so spiritual, so advanced, and then trail down? You would think we'd go the other way.
Well, I mean, one good thing is that it'll start up again, from that point.
From the high point.
But I think it's natural when you consider, okay, you give people some advantages, and those who are smart will take advantage of them in the proper way, and others are going to misuse it. Those who are taking advantage of it properly, they'll get out of the system, because this is another whole aspect of this devolution process, that originally we don't belong in this world. We belong on some other higher level of reality that's beyond all these cycles. It's only some of us that drift down to this level, and then we get caught up in these cycles, and then we have to remain in them. You were mentioning on your next show, you're going to be talking about reincarnation.
Right.
So that's something. So those who take advantage of the process when it's good, in those good times, if they take advantage of the opportunity, they can, through contemplation, yoga, mystic processes, prayer, whatever, they can get out of the whole cycle. If they don't, then you're there for the next act of the show, where you'll still have a chance to get out, but it's going to be a little bit harder. So I think we see this all the time. People are given a chance and say, take advantage of the chance now, because later, say to buy something, because if you don't buy it now, it's going to cost you more later. Maybe some people will buy the object then and take advantage of it, and those that don't, well, they'll have to endure the higher prices later on.
The biblical flood, was that one of these major earth changes that wiped out the civilizations?
I think we see this idea of natural catastrophes, periodic natural catastrophes, mentioned in practically all wisdom traditions in one form or another. I think in the different traditions, they may be described in slightly different ways, but I think it's obvious if we look at the history of the world. You look at the Mayan calendar, for example, which people are talking about now. It talks about periodic catastrophes. The ancient Sanskrit writings talk about these periodic catastrophes. The Bible mentions one, but I believe that there were many before that. So I think we see the same thing reflected in a lot of different wisdom traditions and ancient sources of knowledge.
Michael, devolution, give me your full definition of that, because that was kind of a reversal on what so many people have been thinking.
Well, yes. In, in this earlier book, you know, Forbidden Archaeology, what I did is I presented a lot of evidence, a lot of archaeological evidence in the form of human skeletons, human artifacts, and human footprints going back tens of millions, even hundreds of millions of years. It contradicts, you know, the current theory of human origins, which says, you know, that human beings like us evolved, you know, from some more primitive ape-like ancestors, and that humans like us came into existence only about 100,000 years ago or so. So you've got all this evidence that contradicts the current theory. So scientists and the general public ask me, well, if you're saying we didn't evolve from, you know, the apes and ape men, and then where did we come from? So the book Human Devolution is my answer, you know, to that question, and it's you know, based on my studies in the ancient Sanskrit writings of India. But to put it very, very simply, we didn't evolve up from matter. We devolved or came down from a level of pure consciousness or spirit. And actually what I'm proposing is, I mean, before we even ask the question, where did human beings come from, we should first of all ask the question, what is a human being?
Exactly, and why?
Yeah, because today, you know, a lot of scientists are going to say, well, you're just a bunch of chemicals. That's what you are. You're just a product of random evolution. You're just another kind of animal. You're an evolved ape. You're a bunch of chemicals. That's what you are. However, I think if we actually look at all of the evidence that comes to us from various fields of human experience and scientific investigation, we're going to see it's more reasonable to say that a human being is not just a combination of matter. We're a combination of three things. Matter, yes, that's part of what a human being is, but beyond that, there is a subtle mind element, and then beyond that, there is the element of consciousness or spirit, if you like that word. And when I call these things mind and consciousness elements, I mean real elements, just like gold is an element, silver is an element. I'm not talking about just temporary, you know, bioelectrical activity in the brain. I'm talking about them as real substances. And then once we've established that, there's a lot of evidence that we could talk about that establishes the existence of a subtle mind element that can act in very unusual ways. That takes us into the area of a lot of paranormal research. There's also a lot of scientific evidence that shows there's a conscious self that can exist apart from the body, go from body to body. The reincarnation memories provide evidence for that. Medical reports of out-of-body experiences. So when you put it all together, you see, yes, a human being is a combination of matter, mind, and consciousness or spirit. And then that leads to another idea, namely that we live in a multi-level cosmos where at each level you have beings adapted to the conditions at that level.
Different types?
Yes. We now find ourselves on the level of the cosmos that's dominated by gross matter. And we are living among other living things that are adapted to the conditions there. Beyond that, there is a level of the cosmos dominated by the subtle mental energies, inhabited by beings adapted to the conditions there. And down through history, people have had a lot of different names for these beings. They've called them astral beings, ghosts, spirits, gods, goddesses, things of that sort, angels. And I believe they really do exist. And then beyond that, there is a level of the cosmos dominated by pure consciousness or spirit, and it's inhabited by beings adapted to the conditions there. So what I'm proposing is that we begin our existence at that topmost level of the cosmos, but if we become attracted by the lower energies, we descend into them, we become covered by them, and that's what I mean by devolution, the process by which a pure conscious being descends into these lower levels of the cosmos, becomes covered by the lower energies of mind and matter. However, it is a process that can be reversed, and every great spiritual tradition of the world has some process of contemplation, yoga, prayer, meditation.